knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
Since the introduction of this series, we've talked about how logic is one of the most important tools in philosophy. From before ancient philosophy until today, with cutting-edge technology such as the device you're watching this on, logic has had a pivotal role everywhere, establishing its position as a cornerstone of knowledge. However, although logic is able to ensure the objective validity of an argument with mathematical precision, the means by which people use it may not be so flawless. Your devices certainly have already misbehaved, or maybe even altogether stopped working, due to errors in the logical systems they are based on, from a sudden crash to a terrifying blue screen of death, and humans are no different. Either by mistake, ill intent, or just a desire to make things more interesting, we also commit several errors in logical thinking every day. We may fool ourselves into staying just a few more minutes in bed when we know it'll probably be more, or a politician may try to fool you into voting for them even when they defend policies that will directly harm you. These are logical fallacies, reaching an invalid conclusion either from a faulty coherence between the premises or from external factors that can be psychological, social, or otherwise. In short, it's just bad reasoning. Let's perform a technical and logical analysis of fallacies in order to easily identify them. Bear in mind that there are hundreds of different kinds of fallacies, so let's first give the overall formula on which most of them are based. Then, in the next tutorial, we'll take a look at several examples in order to solidify the concept. The field of fallacies is, surprisingly, one that did not evolve as much as logic itself, nor philosophy or mathematics as a whole. As we've seen before, the study of fallacies started in antiquity and was formally established, like logic itself, by Aristotle. His analysis was limited, but this study was usually considered secondary to logic itself, being only briefly mentioned in specific courses until this day, with a brief uptick in development in medieval philosophy. But like many things in that period, it wasn't of much relevance. Only after the 1950s did researchers realize the disparity of contemporary formal logic and fallacy research, and began to try and understand it. We will not get into this discussion as we have a more practical objective of learning the basics, but be aware that, as with most things in philosophy, the rabbit hole is much deeper. There are two main kinds of fallacies, formal and informal. Formal fallacies are basically invalid arguments, having procedural errors in its inference, either generating nonsense or a seemingly valid result if it weren't for some detail. A simple formal fallacy would be like, every YouTuber is mortal. Joe is not a YouTuber, thus Joe is not mortal. Formally, we'd have, for every X, if X is Y, then X is M. J is not Y, therefore J is not M. This is called denying the antecedent, because instead of applying a valid method of logic, such as a modus ponens, affirming the precedent, or modus tollens, denying the consequent, it generates a faulty argument, since the truth of the premises do not guarantee the truth of the conclusion. We can verify this in this set theory example, where the set of YouTubers is within the set of mortals, but they're not equal, which means something can be in this area where it is mortal, but not a YouTuber. In other words, it tries to convert every YouTuber is mortal to every non-YouTuber is immortal, which doesn't make logical sense. So essentially, formal fallacies are largely each a kind of non sequitur, from Latin, it does not follow, referring to a conclusion which is not a direct result from its premises. But some authors characterize this as a specific kind of fallacy, also known as fallacy of the consequent. Informal fallacies are also partly formal fallacies, but they bring in outside elements to try and make up for their lack in procedural finesse, attempting to appeal to an array of psychological biases. An example would be, Professor Dave said that the Flat Earth hoax is false, therefore it is false. Now, of course, both of these sentences are true. There are countless reasons why Flat Earth is false, as shown in many debunks of mine, where I present detailed arguments which can be logically verified. But me simply saying that it is false is not an argument. You'd have to refer to the arguments and facts I provide, since however well-informed my stance may be, my word alone is not an argument. It cannot even have a proper logical form, since someone said is not reducible to a logical language, so it would just be, the earth is not flat, therefore the earth is not flat, which is clearly not an argument at all. This would be called an argument from authority, a very popular fallacy often seen in support of pseudoscience, where a rogue member of an expert group makes a claim regarding a subject which is perceived to be within their field of expertise, and it is taken to be true for that simple reason. Many unhealthy diets, miraculous concoctions, or nonsense practices are seen as true for some people only because one person with a degree in a relevant area say so, while they ignore a mountain of scientific research from other professionals stating the opposite because they simply don't agree with them or because of many other psychological biases. In this tutorial, we've seen how fallacies correlate with our previous discussion regarding the difference between validity and truth in logic. If an argument is invalid due to its inner structure but still tries to pass as being sound, it is necessarily fallacious. Though its falseness can be a hint that there is something wrong, ultimately it is the procedural analysis of an inference that will tell us whether it is valid or not, as we saw earlier with this example. Every cat is a mammal. My dog is a mammal. Therefore, all dogs are mammals. All sentences are true, but there is no structural connection between them, rendering the argument invariably invalid, a non sequitur, as the conclusion does not follow from the premises. You can embellish all you want with external reasons, eloquence, and other subterfuge, turning it into an informal fallacy, but it would still remain invalid. In the next tutorial, we'll dive into several examples of common fallacies, as well as how to identify and avoid them in order to improve your argumentation skills and ability to discern between good and bad reasoning.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.